Negroes, niggers, black men, and the African American. It was the end of World War II and the times were tumultuous. The United States was on a high stemming from the successful defeat of Germany and Japan. But times were not high in spirited for the African American in the United States. The American Negro returned to the same racist Jim Crow infested America they left when they went to fight the war. Ralph Ellison, like many who served, was profoundly affected by his experiences. He, like many others, was awakened by the European treatment of the black man. For many years before World War II, African-American entertainers recognized that the worldview of the black man in America was far different than the way American whites viewed and treated them. More inclusive, far less prejudiced, and not segregated, many had the opportunity to see equal treatment for the first time. Entertainers such as Louis Armstrong, Duke Ellington, and Josephine Baker flocked to Europe because of the better treatment they received. For many African-American men returning from the war, this equal treatment was eye-opening and made a profound and lasting impression. Ralph Ellison was no different. Ellison, while on leave from the Coast Guard, began to write The Invisible Man in a Vermont Barn. The year was 1945. Behind the scenes, the world was a rapidly changing place. This was especially true of the black man and woman of America, and particularly those in Harlem. And Harlem was the home of Ralph Ellison. By the 1930s and 40s, it had become the black capital of America. It was during the Harlem Renaissance that Langston Hughes, Zora Neale Hurston, and other writers laid the mental seeds for change in the minds of the Negro. Harlem was a place of open discussion. In Harlem, a multitude of social and political organizations vied for the attention and ear of the black community. Groups such as Marcus Garvey's United Negro Improvement Association, the Nation of Islam, the NAACP, Communist Party affiliate groups, and militant civil rights organizations brought a change to the lexicon of America. This change in nomenclature did not go unnoticed by Ellison. You can see and hear its introduction throughout The Invisible Man. Though it is not, in most instances, blatant, it can be found in scenes like the narrator's trip with Mr. Morton and during the address given by Homer A. Barbie. These examples are just a few. Ellison moves smoothly from nigga to negro to black man. He deftly uses the appropriate name at just the right time and in the correct place. Until the period of the 1920s and 30s, the descendants of slaves were identified as niggas and negroes. And while the black man never took to being called nigga, until recent history, but that's another story, the widely accepted identifier was negro. In fact, it was so widely accepted that most African Americans took offense if they were identified by any other nomenclature. Calling a man black was a quick way to get yourself slapped in the mouth, my father once told me. The NAACP, the UNIA called the African American Negro and used the name Negro throughout their literature. It was the more militant civil rights groups that began to pen the identifying label of the black man. These organizations fed the appetite for radical change for the African American. Ellison's Invisible Man was written like an episode of Law and Order. Many of the scenes were gleaned directly from the events of the history of Harlem. For example, the riot that took place in Invisible Man was based on the Harlem race riots of 1935 and 1943. It was the shooting of a black soldier by a Harlem policeman that led to the second race riot in 1943. In 1935, a young Puerto Rican boy was caught shoplifting on 125th Street at the Crest 5 and Dime store. The boy was roughed up by a store employee. But by the time the story spread through the streets, it had changed to the story that the boy had been killed. Two militant groups, the Young Communist League and the Young Liberators, took advantage of the rumored killings of this young boy as fuel to incite the community to riot. These riots had a devastating effect on Harlem. Both the Young Communist League and the Young Liberators are the basis of the Brotherhood and Rasta Destroyers groups in the book. It was groups like these that began to pen and give voice to the vernacular of the black man. The Nation of Islam had its largest growth during this. Elijah Muhammad's calling for the renaming of the Negro to the black man had a profound effect on those groups of young men and women of more radical civil rights groups, groups like the Black Panther Party. It was hammered into the face of America by Malcolm X and the minister of the Nation of Islam. It was no longer acceptable to be a lackey Negro of the white man. These groups told the so-called Negroes that they were black. The Black Panther Party took militancy to a higher level. They promoted black power. The party called for power to the people. It was during this period that the use of the nomenclature black man was solidified as a common identifier for black people in America. As the decades progressed, more politically correct identifier emerged. The use of race identifiers has changed to one's ethnic or geographical identification. The term African American was coined and is in widespread use today. It's amazing how we went from being Africa's stolen legacy, brought to America to become niggers and Negroes under the subjugation of the white man, to liberated black men, and finally to be free African Americans. Hell, I hope Barack's change will last.